Hello and welcome to the last pregame edition of the 9-Yard Line on WGN News Now for the 2022 season. I'm Larry Hawley, and today we'll talk about a number of topics surrounding the Bears as they head toward their season finale with the Vikings at Soldier Field on Sunday. As always, we're live here on this Friday night on Facebook, so if you have a comment on the team, share it, and we may share it at the end of the show. We'll hear from the Bears as their thoughts on safety Damar Hamlin, who suffered a cardiac arrest in a game Monday night with the Bills against the Bengals. That's just part of our play sheet for this show. We'll also hear how the team is watching out for the mental health of their players during an emotional few days. Justin Fields is out, but Chase Claypool is in the lineup, hoping to have a strong finish to what's been a slow start to his Bears career, and maybe see if that little fire-up speech he had on the sidelines against the Lions might actually amount to something in the finale. Hear from the receiver coming up. John Zaghloul of Sports Talk Chicago also joins the show to give us his thoughts on the 2022 season. We'll also talk about a big day for Virginia McCaskey this week, and one major step closer to a major honor that Devin Hester took when it comes to the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Our 9-yard line question of the day concerns the on-field leader of the Bears. What do you think of the job that Matt Eberflus has done during the 2022 season? You can leave your answer on Facebook in the comments, and we'll share it by the end of this show. But let's get things started off with someone not on the Bears, but rather Bills head coach Sean McDermott, who discussed the overwhelming support Damar Hamlin has gotten over the last 4 days.
To know the impact that this has had on so many people, and for now Damar to be awake and his mom to be able to share that with him it's incredible.
A lot of that support the Bills coach is talking about has come from other NFL teams, including the Chicago Bears, who have had the Bills' safety on their mind all week. That kicks off this week's Monsters Mash. The events of Monday night weighed heavily on the Bears as they started work for their season finale against the Vikings on Sunday at noon at Soldier Field. A number of players were watching the moment after Hamlin collapsed on television, making for an emotional final few days of the 2022 season. The moment was especially difficult for Nathan Peterman, who was a teammate with Hamlin at Pittsburgh.
You know, I just talked to him 2 weeks ago when we played him after the game. So it was, you know, extremely just sobering and crazy to see. You know, my wife and I were watching it live and, you know, just really felt for him, felt for everybody that was involved and praying for him a bunch. You know, constantly just thinking about him, praying for him, praying for his family, and going to keep hoping he pulls through.
There's a young man who's 24 years old, 2 years younger than me, in the hospital fighting for his life. Like, that's different. We go out there, and we go out there with this idea that, you know, we play a violent game. We play a violent sport, excuse me. I've played through multiple injuries, seeing guys. I've been one of the people who had the face mask ripped off the helmet and strapped to a board. But, you know, I think Ryan Clark said it, you know, you're just looking for that thumbs up, and there was no thumbs up. And that's scary. Like, to be reminded of, you know, the game that we play, the finality of life, like, that's, when I strap up, I'm not thinking about that. You know what I mean? And it's tough.
A lot of people don't get that, you know, we humans as well. And, you know, when that stuff happens, like, we all got emotions. We all get emotional. And us being professional football players, sometimes I can personally speak for myself. We like to, you know, kind of be that tough guy and act like things don't faze us. But, yeah, it was an emotional moment.
Indeed it was. Now, naturally for the Bears this week, it was all about watching out for the mental health of players, which was a big responsibility for head coach Matt Eberflus. Earlier this week, he had made that a major priority for his team, making available whatever resources the players would need to deal with Hamlin's cardiac arrest. What's helped things is the continued improvement of Damar's condition as he remains at the University of Cincinnati Medical Center. He's now awake and spoke to teammates on Zoom on Friday. For Eberflus, those positive updates have certainly helped things around Hallis Hall.
Yeah, I think it's great. You know, it's really the power of prayer. You know, when you have we had a focused prayer, like I said, Monday's meeting, and we had guys break out from there and talk to their position coaches, and some of that was very emotional, you know, for guys. And we got a chance to talk it out. And I think that, you know, obviously the good news certainly lifts, you know, a heavy heart. You know, when you hear that, that's positive.
As for the game itself, the Bears won't have quarterback Justin Fields. A hip strain is going to keep him on the sidelines for Sunday as his improved second season in the NFL comes to a close. Nathan Peterman gets the start. Chase Claypool will try to finish what's been a slow start to his Bears career against Minnesota. The biggest news he made last week was the frustration he showed after a drive in the second half. That was a three and out. Justin Fields spoke to him about the receiver about that, and he talked about that conversation after the game. So let's hear from Claypool. How was he feeling last Sunday, first starting out with that conversation with Fields?
We had a good little back and forth. Like, you know, I was telling him my side, he was telling me his side, and we came to a common ground. So it's always good when you can have that exchange with a quarterback that always follows up with mutual respect for one another.
What was your side?
My side was just like, you know, we're coming off the field, three and out. Sit on the bench, do the same thing over. You know, some gotta change in that moment. We gotta realize like the drives where we have to score. We have to realize when it's not okay to go three and out. And like we gotta act that way. You know, like if we go three and out, it can't just be okay. And it isn't, but you know what I'm saying? Like we gotta really like have that fire and energy and realize like, yo, like it's time to go. We went three and out two times in a row. They're scoring points, lead's getting bigger. What are we going to do about it?
Now, all Bears fans have their eye on one thing this weekend, and that is the NFL draft standings. Here is the situation if the Bears win. The lowest pick that they will have is fourth in the draft. If they lose, the lowest they can pick is second. And there is one path to the number one pick. The Bears must lose to the Vikings, and the Texans must win over the Colts in Indianapolis. If the Bears were to tie, that won't do it, even if the Texans would win. So the Bears have to lose to Minnesota, the Texans have to win in Indy, and the Bears will get the number one pick. And again, if the Bears lose, the worst they can do is second. Want to remind you that here on the 9-Yard Line, we have a question for you to answer for those of us of you who are watching on Facebook. What is your opinion of the job that Matt Eberflus has done this season? You can go ahead and share your thoughts on that on Facebook if you're watching there, and we'll try to share it about the on the end of the show. Also, if you have any thoughts about the Bears season in general, if you have any thoughts about Damar Hamlin, please share it on Facebook, and we will go ahead and share it by the end of the show. As for the Vikings, the thinking is a lot different from the Bears as they get ready for the NFL playoffs. Minnesota is expected to rotate their starters out of the lineup in the season finale at Soldier Field. That's because they can't get the number one seed in the NFC, and getting the second seed is unlikely, since they would need the 49ers to lose to the lowly Cardinals. The Vikings clinch the NFC North title before Christmas as they return to the playoffs for the first time since 2019. Now we welcome to the 9-Yard Line John Zaghloul of Sports Talk Chicago. John, let's get right to it. Let's take a look at the season as a whole. Yes, Bears fans want to win. The team wants to win. But in many ways, did what have to happen happened here in 2022, where a roster that was light just didn't perform, giving the Bears a shot for a really good number one pick?
I agree, Larry. I mean, I think this was very important for the Bears to go through as a fan base and as a team, really. Have to understand what losing's all about, but have to understand what the future may hold with this team. And I think that's the thing that people are forgetting about. The Bears have $120+ million in cap space available for next year. At this point, as we record, they have the number two overall pick and could hop up to number one, depending on what happens in Houston with Lovie Smith and their potential to lose. So I think the Bears are in prime position for next year. Sure, there was a lot of pain this season, but we did see some growth from some players who we needed to see it from, too. Think about Justin Fields. Pretty good season, nearly broke the NFL single-season rushing record for quarterback and really didn't even play the entire year due to injury. So I think there are a lot of positives to glean on for this team. The record is displeasing. It's tough for Bears fans to go through week in, week out, but I think there are brighter signs ahead. And after this sort of season, next year's the year where we really have to expect something more from them. With all this money, with the top draft pick for Justin Fields developing, I think next year is going to be the year to watch for Bears fans after a tough 2022 season.
Matt Eberflus, what's the impression of the job that he has done in his first year as an NFL head coach?
I like the Bears early in the season under Matt Eberflus. It seems like the steam from this team kind of went out as the year progressed. That game one was a great debut for him, great debut for Ryan Poles. It seemed like everybody was playing really hard and bought into the system. And as the year has progressed, especially last week against Detroit, that was some of the worst effort I've seen from this Bears team all year. Now, granted, you're rebuilding gear. Everybody kind of knows you're tanking. Frustrations are boiling over for sure. But I would have liked to see more effort from players on this team moving forward, especially when Matt Eberflus preached during the entire offseason about the hits principle and finding ways to have guys be involved, force takeaways, which we didn't see much of that as well from this defense this year. So I think next year is going to be the real year to fully critique and evaluate Matt Eberflus. I don't want to hurt him or say he's done a bad job so far, because the players that he's working with, and especially now you trade away Roquan Smith and Robert Quinn midseason, that's going to hurt you. It's going to hurt any coach when you trade away two of your top defensive players, your quarterback's in and out of injuries, and there are so many things that have to be learned from. But next year is going to be the real year of evaluation for him. Same with Ryan Poles, same with Justin Fields, for some who say he may not be there yet. Next year's going to be a big year for this team, and I think this year going through these growing pains only leads to hopeful success next year, because if not, there could be some real problems in Chicago.
John, how has your opinion changed, or has it, of Justin Fields from week one to now?
I think it's changed dramatically. I think for a lot of people, it's changed dramatically. First couple of weeks of this season, I think everybody was rightfully concerned about what he was going to be for the Bears. I mean, there were mock drafts put out week four, and the Bears should draft Bryce Young. Obviously, that's not going to happen now, but it was scary. He wasn't performing. He was regressing even from last year's standards under Matt Nagy and Ryan Pace and a bunch of guys who ended up getting caught or fired or moved down in different capacities. So it was definitely a concerning time for Bears fans and certainly for me. But as the year progressed, that New England game, that's where things somehow, some way decided to take a turn. Fields did really well. He built off of that, put up some great performances, tailed off a bit near the end, but I think that's mainly due to all these issues that he's been facing. He's been going through health problems each and every week. He's been week to week in some cases, and this team has gotten worse and worse progressively. His number one wide receiver at one point was EQ St. Brown or even Webster. The Bears did not have anybody at wide receiver to help him. He's been the most sacked quarterback in the NFL. He actually broke Jay Cutler's single-season Bears sack record. So he's been through a lot this season, so I don't want to sit here and bash on him the last couple of weeks of the year. There was a high point. There were high points overall throughout the year. We did see some sort of progression, and he's earned year three being the starting quarterback for the Bears, and I think that's all you could have asked from Fields for this 2022 season.
Indeed, he showed some improvement throughout. Thank you very much to John for taking some time to talk on this edition of the 9-Yard Line. You can see his entire interview on the Bears 2022 season later this weekend on WGNTV.com. Now, so far on the show, we've covered a number of topics, but there's always a few things we didn't get to. To cover those areas, we have the Bear Essentials on TikTok. Want to remind you fans who are watching on Facebook, we have our 9-yard line question of the day for the show. What is your opinion on the job that Matt Eberflus has done in his not only first season with the Bears, not only first season as an NFL head coach, but his first season as a head coach overall? Leave your answer in the Facebook comments, and we'll share it by the end of the show. Again, want to know what you think if you're watching this on Facebook. What is your opinion of the job that Matt Eberflus has done this season? Let's go ahead and kick off our social media segment. We've talked a lot about Damar Hamlin on this show. Check out this fundraiser by Obvious Shirts that they've had for the Bills' safety, selling his T-shirt for his foundation, putting that money on the GoFundMe page that he has for the foundation. So far, the success has been outstanding. They've sold just under 1,000 shirts and have raised over $15,000. Now, we talked to the founder of Obvious Shirts, Joe Johnson, for WGN News Now, and you can see the full story right now on WGNTV.com. This was a big week around Hallis Hall because of Mama Bear, who celebrated a very important birthday on Thursday. Virginia McCaskey turned 100 years old as the matriarch of the franchise, was honored by the team in a few ways. McCaskey has been the principal owner of the Bears since 1983, after her father, George Hallis, died. She was one of the first women owners of a major professional sports team in North America. There have been plenty of ups and downs for the Bears as of late and in the past during her tenure. And that does include two NFC championships and a Super Bowl XX win. WGN News' Jared Payton, who has known Virginia McCaskey going back to when his dad Walter played for the team, had this to say on her 100th birthday.
My relationship with the McCaskey family is going back to when I was born in 1980. And so just the relationship that I've had with the McCaskeys and also Virginia, she has been the matriarch of that organization, that family. And you talk about football and all that she's seen throughout her years, and to still hear her talk about my dad as being her favorite football player to ever play for the organization, it means the world to me. But it's more of the person, Larry. She's more of just, you know, being that fixture of the Bears. She's the lady that sends my kids Christmas presents every single year and cards on their birthdays. It's that relationship. So it's not just like my dad played for the team. It's my family feels like we're a part of the Bears family. So I feel like she's a part of my family as well. So, you know, thinking about her on her 100th birthday, it's a special day for her. Also a special place in the heart for my family as well.
Thanks to Jared for taking some time to share his thoughts on Virginia McCaskey's birthday. You can actually see his entire interview on that right now at WGNTV.com. Another major story for the Bears happened on Wednesday concerning one of the most electrifying players in NFL history, as Devin Hester takes a step closer to the Hall of Fame. The kick returner is one of 15 modern-era finalists for the class of 2023. That's the spot where Hester got to last year, but wasn't able to quite get into the Hall of Fame, just finished short. The 2006 second-round pick has a lead record 21 non-offensive touchdowns in his career, both in the regular season and postseason, including 20 kick or punt return scores. Perhaps this is the year that Devin Hester gets into the Hall of Fame. I know so many people thought that he might get there last year. We all remember his exploits in his rookie year of 2006. Of course, the electrifying Super Bowl 41 opening kickoff return for a score, pretty much the high point of that game, but easily one of the greatest moments in Chicago Bears history. For those of you watching on Facebook, I'll ask it one more time, our 9-yard line question of the day. What do you think the job that Matt Eberflus has done here in his first season with the Bears, his first season as a head coach in the NFL, and his first season as a head coach overall? If you have a thought on that, leave it in the comments on Facebook, and we may share it by the end of the show. As we usually do here on the 9-Yard Line, we're going to recap some of the big stories of the day concerning the Bears. We'll get to one of these and one of the biggest ones that they've had so far, and that includes how they've dealt with the Damar Hamlin cardiac arrest, how they've done so through the week. Very emotional for a lot of players, not only in the Bears at Hallis Hall, but also all around the NFL. Head coach Matt Eberflus said that the team had many mental health resources ready for the players if they should need it. And he said he prioritized it this week, said they had a few team meetings about it, had a team prayer, really trying to make sure that the Bears are taking care of their mind during a very emotional week. Now, one thing that has really helped to raise the spirits of that team, along with others in the NFL, is DeMar's continued improvement at the University of Cincinnati Medical Center. He is now awake, the breathing tube is out, and he even spoke to teammates via Zoom on Friday. Here's what Matt Eberflus had to say about that, uplifting the spirits of the Bears as they continued to prepare for the Vikings in their season finale Sunday at Soldier Field at noon.
Yeah, I think it's great. You know, it's really the power of prayer. You know, when you have, we had a focused prayer, like I said, on Monday's meeting, and we had guys break out from there and talk to their position coaches, and some of that was very emotional, you know, for guys. And we got a chance to talk it out. And I think that, you know, obviously the good news certainly lifts, you know, a heavy heart. You know, when you hear that, that's positive.
Now, the Vikings will be coming to town much differently than the Bears. They've already clinched their playoff spot. They're probably going to stay in the 3 seed. They could get the 2 seed, but they need to win and then have the 49ers lose to the lowly Cardinals. Probably not going to happen. For that reason, the Vikings are expected to rotate their starters in and out. So Kirk Cousins, Justin Jefferson, probably only see them for part of the game at Soldier Field. Now, the biggest topic of discussion for the Bears and the biggest thing on the line is draft position. So here are the scenarios the Bears have right now. Can they get the first overall pick? Yes, but only one scenario will do it. The Bears have to lose to the Vikings and then have the Texans beat the Colts in Indianapolis. If that happens, the Bears have the number one pick. If the Bears were to tie and the Texans were to win, that wouldn't work. Houston actually has the advantage in strength of schedule. So the Bears have to lose and the Texans have to beat Indy in order for the Bears to get the number one pick. If the Bears lose, the farthest they can fall is to number two, the spot they're at right now. So what happens if they win? Well, they could fall all the way down to the fourth spot, but no farther. And they could actually keep the second overall pick. But in order to do that, they would need the Texans, the Cardinals, and the Broncos all to pull off victories. So again, if the Bears lose, they fall no farther than second. If they win, they fall no farther than fourth. To get the number one pick, they got to lose and then have the Texans pull off the victory. We had a couple of comments here on this edition of the 9-Yard Line. Both of them for Damar Hamlin. Mike Patton sending up the prayers for Damar. Mike, thank you very much for watching this edition of the 9-Yard Line, our last pregame one here for the 2022 season. Sylvia just chiming in recently, same thing, sending her prayers up to Damar Hamlin. He is improving very much. We have a number of stories right now on WGNTV.com concerning that. A few things that we have on there right now, not only the update on his condition, also how the NFL is going to be paying tribute to Damar. There are a few ways they're going to try to do that. You can see that at WGNTV.com. Also mentioned this, Obvious Shirts has been having this effort where they've been selling T-shirts to benefit his foundation. So far, they've sold just under 1,000 and have raised $15,500. Those numbers are as of this afternoon. You can read more about that at WGNTV.com as well this evening. And, of course, this weekend. That's going to do it for this edition of the 9-Yard Line, our final pregame edition for the Bears here in the 2022 season. We will be back on Monday to wrap up the season finale and the season here on WGN News Now. We hope you join us then. And if you want to watch the show again, it will be online here in a couple of minutes. But as always, we appreciate you taking some time of this Friday night to watch the 9-Yard Line. I am Larry Hawley. Have yourself a wonderful evening and a wonderful weekend.